itself in a separate talk, or we can write a textbook on etiology of PCOS, but I'll be very brief here. So if you see PCOS, it is a very complex trait arising from the interaction of both genetic and environmental factors. It's not only purely due to the overweight or obesity, just the environmental factor playing a role. It is a combination of the both. So if you consider PCOS, we can say it is an autosomal dominant inheritance with variable penetrance. So the genetic factors may be multiple things. So that's what it calls two-it hypothesis. The first it is congenital predisposition. The genes heritable traits may be affecting the ovarian function, that is the functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. So the gene genetic affecting the leading to increase in the ovary androgen secretion. The second trait may be predisposition for the insulin resistant obesity or type 2 diabetes. And also congenital virilization, suppose the mother is having CEH or carrier of CEH, a baby is affected by the CEH, again it can lead to PCOS in the future. And fourth, again a very upcoming topic, that is a disturbed fetal nutrition. Both underfed and overfed fetus can lead to PCOS, type 2 diabetes, obesity in the future. So this is called as first eat. So this first eat is aggravated by the postnatal provocative eat, that is the second eat, that is insulin resistance or obesity. So there may be the patient may be having metabolic syndrome or the obesity or puberty per se, because puberty per se, we know that there will be a lot of hormonal changes which leads to the provocation of the PCOS. So basically it is predisposed by the genetic trait and aggravated by the postnatal, mainly insulin resistance. Next slide. So there are a lot of other genes also have been told that causes for the PCOS, like steroidogenic enzyme defects, androgen receptor, gonadotropin receptor defects. So dentin A genes, many genes has been attributed, but it's like, as I told, it's like autosomal dominant inheritance with variable penetration. So it is like type 2 diabetes or hypertension, it's a polygenic. So very difficult to pinpoint that a particular gene is responsible for the PCOS. So multiple factors influence the genetic trait also, and postnatally main contribution is by the obesity or insulin resistance. Again, this is a very interesting slide which tells us about the basic pathophysiology of the PCOS. So I'll brief you about this slide. The red rectangle indicates functional ovarian hyperandrogenism forming from the Tikva cell, and the green oval indicates the pituitary, and black oval indicates the manifestation. Mainly due to the defect in the granulosa cell. And bottom blue rectangle indicates insulin resistance. So the step one, the main denominator in PCOS, if you ask me to say the concept of pathophysiology of PCOS in one line, I will say functional ovarian hyperandrogenism acting as a common denominator with insulin resistance acting as a common aggravator. So this is the very, in a very simple term, we can define etiology of PCOS. So functional ovarian hyperandrogenism is an essential factor for the PCOS. What it tells us about the various manifestations, explains the various manifestations of PCOS also. Oligoannulation, polycystic ovarian morphology, and hirsutism. And for this to sustain, LH is important. So LH is not essential for initiation of functional ovarian hyperandrogenism, but LH is essential for sustaining functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. Okay. Coming to the step two, so the common aggravating factor is insulin resistance. So what is insulin resistance do this? It leads to hyperinsulinism. So this insulin acts on the Tikva cell, leading to increase in the androgen secretion, and also it combines with the androgen, and it has a feed forward effect on the LH cell to increase the secretion of LH. So this is step three. So what is increase LH do is, it again acts on the Tikva cell to increase the androgen levels, and also it acts on the granulosa cell to do premature luteinization of the granulosa cell. So both this insulin, LH and androgen acts on the granulosa cell, leads to increased secretion of the sex steroid, that is the estrogen level, and also leads to anovulation and polycystic ovarian morphology. So step four is, this increased estrogen decreases the FSH level. Step five is, again this hyperinsulinism can lead to deposition of fat, and fat again leading to insulin resistance. So this forms a vicious cycle. So this is the very simplest way of explaining the pathophysiology of PCOS. So basically, the common denominator is functional ovarian hyperandrogenism, and it is aggravated by the common aggravating factor is the insulin resistance. This both leads to different manifestation like oligoannulation, polycystic ovarian morphology and hirsutism, various cutaneous manifestation. Next slide. Balaji, there is some problem in the slides. Okay, next slide. Okay. So again, this slide shows that insulin resistance along with hyperandrogenism leads to imbalance in the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, hypothalamus pituitary ovarian axis, and also reproductive failure, and also other manifestations like dyslipidemia, hypertension, or obstructive sleep apnea, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So various problems are due to this combination of this hyperandrogenism and insulin resistance. Next slide. So now we know the importance of insulin resistance in polycystic ovarian disease. So how to assess insulin resistance in our clinical practice? Next slide. The most simplest way and is clinical examination. So look for acanthosis nigricans, look for skin tags, look for central obesity or truncal obesity. So these are the valid signs tell us that the patient has significant insulin resistance. And also, in a way, it also helps us to explain to the patient that importance of the underlying insulin resistance or the importance of reducing the weight. So if you show them this signs, that is, if the patient has acanthosis nigricans or skin tags, and you tell them these are the signs of insulin resistance, so it's very essential to reduce the weight, the patient will fall over and this religiously. Next slide. So there are various ways to measure in the laboratory. This is mostly in the research laboratory. So they do the clamp study. So they infuse insulin and glucose at a particular rate to maintain the plasma glucose within the range. So they measure the glucose infusion rate. So the higher the glucose infusion rate, better is the insulin sensitivity. If the patient has insulin resistance, they will require lower glucose insulin rate because the glucose disposal in the muscles or fats will be less. So lower the glucose infusion rate, higher the insulin resistance. Next slide. And very common investigation what we do in our clinical practice is measuring the OMA-IR based on the fasting glucose value and fasting insulin. So OMA-IR score, you can see in the lower right column. So excellence, if it is less than 1, and average is 1.75. So anything more than 2, we say it's clinical significant. But personally, I tell the patient to keep it less than 1.5. So again, there are some caveats in measuring this one because always it is not reproducible based on the values, the insulin resistance values also change, like the fasting plasma glucose variability is high. So obviously there will be variability in the OMA-IR also. And if there is a beta cell dysfunction or hyperglycemia is already there, then this measurement is not very useful. So if you have already a PCOS patient with the diagnosed type 2 diabetes, there is no point in measuring the OMA-IR. Imprecise, already I told, that's a poor reproducibility. Next slide. So do measurement of insulin resistance add any value to management of PCOS? None of the societies, international societies or Indian guidelines are advising to measure the insulin resistance because it is not going to change the line of treatment. So if you see, insulin resistance is a main pathogenic cause for the PCOS, but it's not an endpoint of therapy. All the clinician must be knowing, we'll be targeting restoration of ovulation, or resolution of the cutaneous manifestations like reduction of hirsutism, acne, or achievement of fertility, or in the long run, preventing the diabetes, obesity, other metabolic or vascular complications. These are the clinical endpoints. We are not targeting insulin resistance. It's just a surrogate marker. That's it. Okay, so there is, if you ask me, there is no additional advantage of doing insulin resistance for all the patients. But if you think the patient is not following your advice or they are not able to understand what's happening, along with the clinical signs like acanthosis nigricans, in that you can do the OMA-IR and tell them this is the main cause or this is the aggravating factor for your all the complaints. So you have to follow the whatever advice we are giving, like lifestyle drugs strictly, so that this can be brought down and there will be improvement in the symptoms. For that purpose, you can do the testing. Otherwise, it is not routinely recommended. Next slide. But it's very important to detect glucose intolerance. So insulin OMA-IR is different, glucose intolerance is different. So it's always better to do GTT or check for the HbA1c in all your PCOS patients, because most of these patients will land up in type 2 diabetes in future, and also they are at risk for developing gestational diabetes in future. So you should assess the whether the patient is having glucose intolerance at baseline or under follow-up or not. It's very, very important. Next slide. Because in this group, if you do a proper intervention, we can prevent type 2 diabetes also. So this is like a diabetes prevention program. We can do it in the PCOS patient. So we should do it. Even if you see the data, the prevalence of glucose intolerance is very high in PCOS patients. You can run through the slides. Next. So this is data from various universities, Chicago, Pennsylvania. Next. Next. Yeah, enough. So before. One slide before. Yeah. If you see the type 2 diabetes prevalence, it's almost 8 to 10%. And impaired glucose tolerance is there is in the all the four universities study, it's almost 25 to 30%. So almost 45 to 50% of the PCOS patients have some form of glucose intolerance. So it is very important to the GTT or to the assess the glucose tolerance in the PCOS patient. Next slide. So briefly, what we can do in our clinical practices, history is very, very important. So look for the PCOS, different PCOS symptoms, because we all know that PCOS is a different spectrum. Each patient can present with different symptoms. So look for, ask for menstrual history and look for the cutaneous signs and take proper family history, history of diabetes, premature CVD, endometrial CA, because as I told, there is a kind of autosomal dominant inheritance if they're in PCOS. So family history of even PCOS is very, very important, because the data shows that 25% of the women will have family history of PCOS. Even family history of polycystic ovarian morphology is also important, because the data are there to show that if the mother has polycystic ovarian morphology or the sister has polycystic ovarian morphology, there is a chance of developing PCOS in the daughter or the sibling. So family history is very, very important. As for premature coronary cardiovascular disease, as for metabolic syndrome, as for endometrial carcinoma, because we know that PCOS is a significant risk factor for endometrial carcinoma. So ask history for the obstructive sleep apnea. Examination, calculate BMI for all the patient and measure the waist circumference and look for acanthosis nigricans, skin tags, etc. And measure BP. Again, like documenting glucose intolerance, measuring BP is very, very important. And lab, if you are not doing insulin resistant, it's okay, but at least get on OGTT and fasting lipid profile. And if possible, SGOT, SGPT also, because most of these patients will have NAFLD also. Next slide. At least this basic investigation should be done with respect to metabolic and vascular complication. So I'm not going to the infertility part or the oligomenorrhea part, because that's a different spectrum. I'm just limiting myself to the metabolic and vascular complication. So these are the known associated morbidity with PCOS. Most of these complications are due to underlying insulin resistance. Obesity, endometrial carcinoma, diabetes and cardiovascular risk all are mainly due to insulin resistance. Next slide. Next slide. And newer associated morbidities, again, look for these complications also. Sleep apnea, very, very important. You know, obese patients, ask for history for sleep apnea. Many times, underlying hypertension or stress can be due to obstructive sleep apnea. So ask for the history. And also, as I told you earlier, it's better to get SGOT, SGPT also to look for non-alcoholic fatty acids. And also, many of our patients, due to the stress, also by labeling them as PCOS, they may land up in depression, anxiety also. To ask for those issues also, very important, because taking care of those things also very, very important. Next slide. So first part is over. So far I discussed about the how insulin resistant acts as an aggravating factor for the functional ovarian hyperandrogenism, how this combinedly leading to various manifestation of the PCOS and also leading to various metabolic and vascular complication. And how practically we can measure or evaluate for the insulin resistance in our patients, and what are the long-term complications due to underlying insulin resistance in the PCOS. So now we'll go to the association of the PCOS and GDM. Next slide. So there is a very strong epidemiological link saying that PCOS patients are at risk for developing type 2 diabetes and GDM. So as I told already, insulin resistance will be there in at least 70 to 80% of the PCOD cases. And PCOD leads to increase in the risk of type 2 diabetes by 1600%, 16 times more than the general population. And PCOD increases the risk of GDM by more than 200%. And almost 50 to 60% of the GDM patients, eventually in the long run, they will develop type 2 diabetes. So diagnosing glucose intolerance as I told already is very, very important. Next slide. So why diagnosing glucose intolerance or GDM is important in PCOS? Because, next slide. Because by diagnosing glucose intolerance or GDM yearly, we can prevent both maternal and fetal complications. Maternal complications like preeclampsia, polyhydramnios, and recurrence of GDM in the next pregnancy, or the patient developing type 2 diabetes in the long run. This is if patient develops GDM. Okay, but pre-existing type 2 diabetes, again, we need to look for the microvascular complication. We need to evaluate whether the patient is having nephropathy or retinopathy. We should monitor that also, because in pregnancy, the microvascular complication can get aggravated. So those things also very, very important. So PCOS patient, even before getting pregnancy, it's always better to look for the whether there is type 2 diabetes there or not. Coming to fetal complication, next slide. So by properly managing the glucose during pregnancy, we can prevent prenatal mortality, also perinatal mortality, and various complications associated during the delivery. Next slide. So we can prevent macrophthalmia, shoulder injury, shoulder dystocia, and after delivery, if we manage the glucose properly, hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, and hyperbilirubinemia can be reduced. As I told again, if there is a pre-existing type 2 diabetes, we should look for the congenital malformation in the baby, because all we know that GDM usually develops in the later part of pregnancy. So main complications are this macrophthalmia, hypoglycemia, hypercalcemia, etc. But if there is a pre-existing type 2 diabetes, there is a chance of congenital malformation also, that we should look for. Next slide. And again, why it's important to diagnose GDM? Again, now the upcoming topic, that is the primordial prevention. So GDM, the fetal programming can happen during the fetal life itself. So if there is a oocyte state, that is GDM, the fetal pancreas will secrete higher than the normal insulin. So oocyte maternal state leads to fetal programming, leading to fetal pancreas for insulin overproduction. So eventually in the long run, what will happen is there will be yearly beta cell exhaustion. So whenever there is an insulin requirement rises, the pancreas will fail to reciprocate, because already the beta cells are exhausted. So it leads to type 2 diabetes when the fetus becomes an adult. So this is called a fetal programming for the adult disease. So overfed state like GDM can lead to type 2 diabetes in adults due to yearly beta cell exhaustion. Next slide. So this is the opposite one, underfed state, maternal starvation. So in this, what will happen is the fetal pancreas is programmed for decreased production of insulin. So the fetal pancreas produces less capacity of insulin. This is called plasticity. So whenever the insulin requirement rises during the adult, the pancreas again fails to produce the required insulin. So leads to type 2 diabetes. So both overfed state and both underfed state can lead to fetal programming in the pancreas, and that can lead to type 2 diabetes in the future. Type 2 diabetes or obesity also, and also PCOS. Next slide. So that's why. So diagnosing GDM and managing GDM or type 2 diabetes during PCOS or any pregnancy is very, very important. So by maintaining euglycemia, you prevent overfeeding and or also underfeeding. So there is less chance of developing adult disease like obesity, metabolic syndrome, PCOS, diabetes, etc. So very, very important. So for this, we should know whether the particular pregnant patient is suffering from dysglycemia. Next slide. Now, another importance of diagnosing GDM during pregnancy is, as I told you earlier, 50 to 60% of these patients eventually will have type 2 diabetes. So most of the pregnant patient, GDM pregnant patient, if you see after delivery, the insulin resistance will go down, because you all know that during pregnancy state, placenta secretes various hormones. So insulin is on one side and most of the other hormones are anti-insulin. They lead to increase in the blood glucose. So there is a balance between insulin and other hormones. Once the pregnancy is over, the insulin resistance will decrease. So most of this pregnant patient will have euglycemia. But eventually, if you compare with the patient who doesn't have GDM during pregnancy and patient who had GDM during pregnancy, if you follow up, most of this GDM patient will develop diagnosis earlier compared to the other set of patients. So it's very important to document GDM, because GDM is very, very common in PCOS patients. So you should look for glucose intolerance during pregnancy. Next slide. the epidemiology data, I think you all must be knowing more than me. Next slide, because we must be seeing more number of pregnant patients. And we all know that GDM is like a pandemic, as an epidemic also is pandemic. So most of the patients are having, even non-PCOS patients are also having some form of glucose intolerance, even mild impaired fasting glucose or IGT. Most of the times we manage with diet alone, but still it's very, very common nowadays, GDM. So we should look for glucose intolerance in most of our patients, all our patients. Next slide. So again, if you see the American guidelines, they will say risk-based screening for the pregnant patient, that is particularly first trimester screening. But Asian, South Asians, we are as ethnicity, we are at high risk for developing gestational diabetes. So there is no doubt we should do two screenings. One is at the first trimester, at the diagnosis of pregnancy, it's better to get an OGTT. If you think that the patient is having high risk for diabetes like PCOS or family history of diabetes, obesity, I will suggest better get GTT rather than going for fasting plasma glucose, random or HbA1c. But many times we are seeing that if you are doing only random, you are missing many cases of diabetes mellitus. So in Indian patients, ethnicity is there. So we must do first trimester screening. If there is no risk factor for diabetes, then you can do routine testing like fasting, postprandial or HbA1c. But if you think Indian patient with risk factor for diabetes, then like underlying PCOS or obesity, family history, significant family history, better get OGTT at the first trimester itself. And again, if it's normal, always do a second screening at 24 to 28. So two screening is must in our Indian patients. And there are a lot of controversy regarding testing protocol, whether to do two-step or one-step or DIPSI criteria. I will say whatever protocol you are following in your institution, know the positive and negative of the protocol, because the sensitivity and specificity of different protocols are different. So you should know what are the sensitivity of that particular test and follow that protocol in your clinic. That is the best way of doing that. So I don't want to suggest you follow a single step ADA criteria or follow the ACOG criteria. So whatever you are comfortable, do it. But do it two times. For the first trimester early management and taking help of the
Hello, doctor.
Next slide, please. Yeah, coming to the last part of my topic, so management. Next slide. So I'm not going to details. Next slide. Next. So I'm not going to detail about the insulin therapy, etc. I'll just brief the management principles, and I'll go into the inositol part. Next slide. Next. So this all you must be knowing that. So if you manage hyperglycemia well, if you maintain euglycemia for a long time, the complication rates are going to be less, both maternal and fetal. So it's very important to maintain the values within the range. For fasting glucose should be less than 95, and 2 hours postprandial should be less than 120. If you are monitoring 1 hour, it should be less than 140. SMBG is very, very essential. As I already told, diet and exercise are very, very essential. So at present, we have metformin and insulin as an approved drug by most of the international bodies for management of gestational diabetes or type 2 diabetes with pregnancy. But inositol, I will discuss how inositol addresses insulin resistance and the safety data also. Next slide. So these are the various treatment regimens available. So metformin, mainly it attacks insulin resistance, wide experience, almost the molecule is in the market for 3 to 4 decades. We all know it's very, very safe, and most of the gynecologists and endocrinologists use this molecule for PCOS, and patients used to take this molecule during their first trimester also. And it's very, very safe. Even the MIC trial, metformin in GDM trials are there, and even follow-up data are there, shows that this molecule is very safe. And only problem is, many patients doesn't tolerate it, so that is the only thing. And if the glycemic levels are very high, this alone may not be enough. So we have insulin. Most of the insulin are approved for the use in during pregnancy, except for the newer analogs. Most of the insulin are safe. very efficacious, very we can effectively control the glucose, but the problems are injectable and hypoglycemia risk. The patient has to do regular SMBG, otherwise hypoglycemia risk is there. And if you are using more short acting or rapid acting insulin, there is a high chance of weight gain and also large for gestational age babies. But it doesn't attack the insulin resistant root cause. It mainly, it's like a symptomatic therapy. It decreases only glucose level. So ionicetol therapy, it addresses the root cause like insulin resistance, leads to favorable fetal and maternal outcomes. It is safe. It doesn't have GI intolerance or weight gain, hypoglycemia risk like insulin. But the main cons are limited usage experience, and we don't have many data. Large randomized controlled studies are not there. And it is not approved by major international bodies. But again, it is in for nutraceuticals. It's not like a pharmaceuticals like metformin or insulin. So we may not have the approval by the DCGA or FDA for these molecules because it's a nutraceutical. So we need to have more data, randomized controlled study, to show the efficacy, because safety is also it's more safe. So mostly we need to have more efficacy data. Next slide. So let's see briefly about ionicetol used in GDM. Next slide. So ionicetol, we all know that it has it acts as a messenger, key messenger in various pathway, particularly in the insulin, post-insulin receptor pathway, it has a major role. Next slide. So it has role in many areas like mood, elevator, and it's essential for cell survival and growth, and it is essential for development and function of peripheral nerves. It has role in osteogenesis, and it improves the insulin sensitivity. And also in the reproduction, it improves the oocyte quality, and also it can lead to normal ovulation cycle. It has various role in our day-to-day life. Next slide. You can run through the slides. Next. So myo-ionicetol and D-chiro-ionicetol. Next. I think someone has messaged. No, voice is poor. Is it audible now? Balaji, can you confirm? Is it audible? Okay. So as I told, myo-ionicetol and D-chiro-ionicetol combinedly, it can lead to improvement in the insulin receptor by recruiting the GLUT4 receptor and also by various post-receptor mechanism. But most important thing is all this effect takes when the ratio is in 40:1. Even we have international data, they have recommended this ratio is essential for its action. Next slide. So this is the normal follicular fluid. In this, the myo-ionicetol, D-chiro-ionicetol is in the ratio of 100:1. But what happens in PCOD is, next, there will be significant reduction in the myo-ionicetol, almost to the tune of 500-fold. So the ratio is altered. So the D-chiro-ionicetol ratio is more than the myo-ionicetol. So this is also in a cause for the insulin resistance. Next slide. So ratio is like 0.2:1. Next slide. So for optimal therapy, 4 grams per day is required, and the ratio should be in the 40:1. These two are very, very important. And sometimes due to the palatability, it's better to have in the powder form rather than tablet or capsules. Next slide. There are two international data for this myo-ionicetol and D-chiro-ionicetol. Next slide. So this is one study published in European Journal of OG and Reproductive Biology. I think it's in 2015. Next. So what they have told is, again, the 40:1 ratio is very, very important, and 4 grams per day is very, very important. And they have demonstrated there is improvement in the metabolic syndrome, the metabolic profile, and the ovulation profile with usage of myo-ionicetol and D-chiro-ionicetol. Next slide. Now again, another one data from the, it's a meta-analysis published again in a British Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology. What they have concluded is, it's a meta-analysis. Ionicetol appears to regulate menstrual cycles, improve ovulation, and induce metabolic changes. So both its action on the metabolic changes also, and in the reproductive part also. However, evidence is lacking for pregnancy, miscarriage, or live birth. As I told, we need to have long-term data because it's a new concept. and we are having data since for last 3-4 years only. So we should have long-term data or some randomized controlled trial to say that it improves the outcome, mainly in pregnant patients, there is decrease in miscarriage or a decrease in the maternal and fetal complication. Or in PCOS patient, there is improvement in the ovulation rate, that we have data, improvement in the ovulation and improvement in the live birth, increase in the live birth compared to the placebo. Those are the data we need to have more. We want to have more like randomized controlled study. But what I will say is with the available data, at least this is safe therapy because it's a nutraceutical. And data shows that definitely there is improvement in the metabolic change profile and also the ovulation profile. So probably it can have impact in improving the pregnancy rate and also decreasing the severity of GDM or preventing GDM. And in many patient infertility patients, I use this molecule and also in GDM patients. And by using this molecule and lifestyle modification, many patients we have avoided insulin therapy also. Next slide. This is my personal experience. Next slide. So summary, as I told, if you want me to say PCOS in a single sentence, functional ovarian hyperandrogenism is a common denominator with insulin resistance as a common aggravating factor. So insulin resistance is very, very essential. And not only PCOS, if you see most of the present lifestyle problems, disease like hypertension or dyslipidemia, CAD, OSA, insulin resistance plays a major role. So as a responsible persons in the society, we have to address this issue from the school children itself. So we should talk more about insulin resistance to the future generations so that in the long run, the people will not develop chronic disease like PCOS, diabetes, hypertension, etc. So the concept of insulin resistance, we have to take for to the society as such. And insulin resistance, most of the times we can recognize clinically itself, and it's very, very important. Tell the patient that this in the acanthosis nigricans and skin tags are clinically very important, and it is surrogate marker for insulin resistance, and lifestyle modification is very, very essential. And most of the times, you will not require lab tests to document insulin resistance. If you want to do the testing, do GTT, lipid profile, and look for transaminitis. These are very essential tests, and clinically measure the waist circumference and take proper history. That gives more information rather than measuring the insulin resistance. And PCOS and insulin resistance are chronic disease. It just doesn't stop with pregnancy or delivery of the patient. Even after that, that person is at risk for diabetes, obesity, CVD, and gynecologists, you know, they are risk for endometrial carcinoma. So lifelong monitoring or lifestyle modifications are very, very important. The link between PCOS and GDM is very, very important, and it's very important concern because you all know that the incidence of GDM is on rise. PCOS may be one of the important reasons, and also we know that there is a common interlink, insulin resistance is there. So as I told, it's very essential, do 2 times screening, and if possible, do GTT at the first trimester also, and also the second trimester. And the protocol varies between the institute, whatever you are comfortable, follow that protocol. And this combination of myoinestrol and dinestrol in the ratio of 40:1 and 4 grams per day is essential. And the data look promising and safe, but we need to have more randomized controlled trial. I think that's it. Thank you. I'm happy to take some questions.
Sir, this is Dr. Kiran from Shield, sir. Thank you so much for a wonderful, wonderful presentation. I think you covered all the facets of PCOS, right from how it starts from a fetus and how it develops into a GDM, sir. So I would request the audience to type in their questions to chat, and I can ask sir. Sir, already there are some questions, sir. So the first question is from Dr. Anuja K. She wants to know, for PCOS patients, sir, is it a must to do fasting insulin in all patients?
If you ask the straightforward answer, no. But I'll tell you what I will do in my clinical practice. Fasting insulin, yes, no. International bodies advising us to get the fasting insulin. But in the clinical practice, it acts as a good motivating factor. For example, if you say this is the OMAIR is something 5 and 1.5 is your target. And if you reduce this level to significantly less than 1.5, there will be good weight reduction, because we all know that insulin is a very anabolic hormone. Insulin will not lead to weight loss. So by reducing the insulin resistance and reducing the insulin level only, the patient is going to have weight loss, and also all our symptoms are going to improve. So that will be a motivating factor for her. So I'll tell her, so by documenting this Omaya, you just follow this diet pattern, exercise, and whatever medication we are giving. So if your insulin resistance comes down, there will be resolution of your symptoms and also weight loss. Only for that purpose, that too, if patient is not following your advice properly, I will do the Omaya or fasting insulin. Otherwise, in routine practice, it's not indicated, madam.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Sonal. She wants to know if the patient HbA1c values in the pre-diabetic range, should we start metformin or myo-inositol?
Pre-diabetic range, again, in the long run, they are at risk for diabetes or GDM. So you can start the combination of the both also, madam. You can give myo-inositol plus metformin also. There's no wrong in that. And so many patients may not like to start metformin because they will have stigma that they are starting on metformin. So in that patient, if it's the pre-diabetic range, you can start them on myo-inositol, do the lifestyle modification. After 3 months, you can reassess and start metformin also. So both options are fine. Either you can start both together also, or put them on myo-inositol and then put them on metformin. Both are okay.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Payal Bhargava. So she gives a patient case scenario, sir. So if there is a patient who is 48 years old, the weight of the patient is 90 kgs, and only her HbA1c is constantly at 6.2. All the remaining parameters are normal. The FBS, PPBS is normal. She wants to know if the patient should be started on metformin, sir.
So again, it's a 48-year-old. So if I am putting her on treatment also, my target will be of HbA1c less than 6.2 only. So at this age and HbA1c of 6.2, I will recommend only for lifestyle modification to maintain the HbA1c at this level. Because by reducing further HbA1c, I'm not going to gain anything because HbA1c is a J-safe curve. By reducing the HbA1c too much also, there is a risk for cardiovascular. So I will try to maintain the same HbA1c. So I'll only advocate lifestyle modification rather than putting her on metformin. I will not start metformin now.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Jaya Bharati. What would be the duration of usage of myo-inositol in these patients?
Again, it's very difficult. As I told, we don't have long-term data. And also, if you ask the same question for metformin also, we don't know. Because if you say the weight loss, pregnancy is outcome, then obviously you can say till the delivery, you can use the metformin. Similarly, myo-inositol also you can use like that. And after delivery, you can stop it. But one thing is important is we have to understand is lifestyle modification. That is the main important thing. So that should be the denominator. All this metformin, myo-inositol, super added, we are treating because we are treating according to the symptoms. So for that particular patient, if the pregnancy is the issue or GDM is the issue, so do the molecule till the delivery happened or till the patient becomes pregnant, give it to them and then you can stop it. Discuss with them, but lifestyle modifications are essential.
Thank you, sir. Any more questions, doctors, to sir? Sir, I had a couple of questions with your permission. Okay, there's one question, sir. Sorry. Sir, from again Dr. Jaya Bharati, is there any trial of myo-inositol for male patients?
There are few data, theoretical data, so that it improves the sperm motility and sperm count. But I am not aware of any randomized controlled trial to say that this molecule improves the sperm count or sperm this one. So theoretically, it can have impact, but I don't know whether there is any data on this one.
Right, sir.
The doctor from the field can answer on this. Any data are there?
Sir, there are few data actually, which are very recent. I'll share them with you.
Probably you can share the data with us.
Surely, sir. Sir, the next question is, I think the doctor's name is not there. They want to know what is the genetic basis of PCOS, sir?
I told at my talk itself, there are two main genetic traits. One is genetic traits for the functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. Second is genetic traits for diabetes, insulin resistance itself. So it's a polygenic. We can't pinpoint what is the genetic trait. And also, again, there are data so that maternal PCOS, PCOM, polycystic ovary morphology, hyperandrogenism in the mother, testosterone, SHBG levels, all this can lead to PCOS in the next generation also. And also metabolic syndrome in the family can lead to PCOS. And genes, various genes has been attributed, like gonadotropin, gonadotropin receptor, insulin, fibrillin 3, SHBG, many genes has been attributed. Because autosomal dominant with variable penetrant, very difficult to pinpoint a single gene. So all these things, multiple factors contributes to the PCOS, genetic basis of PCOS.
Thank you, sir. So a couple of more questions. So the next question is from Dr. Menmani Murugan. How to diagnose diabetes in patients? Would you go for OGTT or HbA1c?
So in pregnant patients, GTT is better rather than HbA1c, because the pregnancy itself can alter the HbA1c values. In a normal patient, non-pregnant patients, now we have a recommendation with HbA1c also. So if a patient is not comfortable in getting GTT, you can go for HbA1c. Otherwise, GTT is ideal. So both are okay for non-pregnant patients. Pregnant patients, ideally GTT.
Requesting all the doctors to mute their phone. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Alka Singh. Is it safe to give myo-inositol during the first trimester of pregnancy?
Yeah, it's a nutraceutical. It doesn't have any. It's not a pharmaceutical. So. But I don't know. I use it during first trimester. If it's a mild diabetes dysglycemia, I use it. I have not, because I use it in many patients. There is no side effects. So, and also many PCOS patients, they used to continue this molecule when they become pregnant also. So there is no side effects so far. I have seen, but I don't know any long term data are there. Kiran, you can answer.
Yes, sir. Sir, there are four studies which have been. Having follow-ups in terms of both maternal as well as fetal outcomes. They all have been done by Diana and her group. And they show a very, very safe profile. In fact, some of them have been followed up for 2 years also, and they're extremely safe, sir. I'll share those data with you, sir.
Yeah, that's right. There should not be any problem with using this molecule in first trimester.
Definitely, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Sharada. Can myo-inositol be used if established or in established diabetic patients already on metformin?
Already on diabetic patient, if it is a PCOS or GDM patient, yes, we can use it. But if it's a non-routine diabetic patient, non-PCOS, I don't use. I go for the routine diabetes management, because now in diabetes, let's say we have a lot of molecules to use for weight loss and other things, which prevents cardiovascular complication and all. So I will use those molecules, because we have more data for that. But for PCOS or GDM, yes, if already established diabetic also, I will use it.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Dr. Sonal. Your opinion on the first line of medical management or drugs in hyperandrogenism, and how long should we give this treatment?
Again, it varies from person to patient to patient. So that the first line of drugs are the oral contraceptive pills, and if required, anti-androgenic, like I prefer to use spironolactone. So those are the first line drugs, and we all know that it's very difficult to treat the symptoms like hirsutism or acne. So most of the times they will require oral drugs plus some cosmetic therapy also. So unless the patient is having underlying significant obesity or insulin resistance, they have reduced significant weight with which the hyperandrogenism relieves. Otherwise, it's very difficult to treat hyperandrogenism longer. So usually the guidelines are OC pills plus or minus antiandrogens, and better to have cosmetic therapy also, if mainly if it's a PCOS, lean PCOS, particularly because lean PCOS, most of the lean PCOS, the main presentation will be there. Cutaneous manifestation like hirsutism or acne rather than the anovulation or infertility. So in those patients, it's better to do the medications and also ask them to go for the cosmetic therapy. And once they have a reasonable outcome, then we can stop it. But usually at least we need to give them for 6 months at least.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Divya Selvamani again confirms your comment that she uses the myonicetol routinely on PCOS patients getting pregnant.
Yeah, I know that.
Yes. So the next question is again from Dr. Ayan Modi Murugan. So there's a patient scenario. So you have a PCO patient with impaired glucose tolerance, and that patient has become pregnant. So the question is, should we start insulin or metformin is better, or should we do the GCP once again in the first trimester?
Oh no, if it's glucose intolerance has been documented and patients on therapy, so no need to do the GCP. If it's a patient is doesn't have glucose intolerance, no diabetes only, we are going to do the GTT. So it should be very clear, because we do get many patients already diagnosed diabetes getting GTT, so it's not required. It's very, because already established diabetes, it should be very clear. And again, there are criteria for insulin, the onset of the GTT, or when we are making the diagnosis of GDM, if the fasting glucose is more than 110 or random is more than 200, directly we need to start the patient on insulin. So there are criteria are there, so we have to follow this criteria. If it is a mild derangement, then probably lifestyle modification plus metformin or myonestrol will help. But if the derangement is much, then obviously directly we need to go for insulin.
Thank you, sir. Any more questions to sir, doctors? Sir, I had one question which I always wanted to ask you. Sir, there are a lot of studies which say that this intrauterine environment is a big risk factor for that fetus to develop PCO milestones earlier. So is it really true, sir? Lots of studies are coming up in that sense.
Yeah, intrafetal programming leads to?
Yes, sir. So some of the data says, sir, if the intrauterine environment is highly risky, like the mother is PCO or GDM, those babies can develop the PCO milestones faster in the future.
Yeah, as I told, I discussed about that fetal programming. So the intrauterine, there is not only this like GDM, even the preeclampsia, gestational hypertension, maternal obesity. So all these things, if there is additional like stress for the baby, so there will be a programming happening in the fetus itself. So that leads to obesity, childhood obesity, type 2 diabetes, insulin resistance, etc. Even the small for gestational, large for gestation, all these kids are prone for future complications. So there are very, very, very documented data out there. Even there will be overgrowth, and the data are there from 4 years or 5 years of age itself, where these people are developing childhood obesity and all. So a lot number of data. So that's what it's primordial prevention has come into play. So managing diabetic patients with good glycemic control and good BP control are very, very essential.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one last question, I think from Manisha Busi, we can take that, sir. Sir, in which form is myonicetol better given?
I discussed in that. So because the 4 gram is very, very important. The ratio of 40:1 is very, very important. And also due to palatability, it's better to give it in the powder form.
Thank you, sir. So, if no further questions, I would like to take this opportunity to first of all thanks to sir to spare this his very valuable time and give a fantastic presentation. I think sir has given a very, very great perspective, covered all the things which is, I think the GDM is going to be the next pandemic, you already put it. The increasing diabetes population in India as well. Sir, one more question, sorry sir. From Dr. Nirmala Devi, myonicetol, decarnicetol, how long and how many times to repeat it?
So how long already discussed, till, yes, because each patient is different, so whatever we are targeting, till that we need to do. So very difficult to say how long, because as I told, it's a lifelong therapy. So if patient is planning for pregnancy, till then give it and then stop it. How many times to repeat? As I told, 4 grams per day we need to give.
Thank you, sir. Lots of compliments from doctors for giving a lot of clarification and explanation.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you everyone for attending the webinar.
Thank you, sir. I would also like to thank
the during this COVID pandemic, I guess gynecologists are the people who are very busy. Rest of us are all mostly doing webinars or doing the teleconsultation. I really appreciate them for attending the webinar.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.